Hello. I will talk today about SGLT2 inhibitors and their implications from clinical trials and guidelines. I am from the University of Leuven, and here are my disclosures. I do advise most companies who make tools or agents that help us treat people living with diabetes. Now, you all know this figure coming from the updated ADA-ESD consensus, where we have a major role for SGLT2 inhibitors. We have a major role for these agents in individuals just with type 2 diabetes, but we also have a very prominent role for them in individuals with heart failure and chronic kidney disease, and after the GLP-1 receptor agonist, also in those with atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease. So very prominent role for these agents in individual with problem with their hearts and also problems with their kidneys, where we say that independent of hemoglobin A1C, they should be in the treatment of people living with type 2 diabetes with these problems. Now, where does this attention for heart disease, atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease, heart failure, and kidney disease come from? Of course, it comes from, first of all, the observation that in individuals with type 2 diabetes, there are life years lost. And indeed, the younger women or men with type 2 diabetes are the greater number of life years lost there are compared to people without type 2 diabetes. And the years lost are mainly due to cardiovascular disease. And if we look at the lives years lost, they are more impressive in those with diabetes and cardiovascular disease than in those with diabetes without cardiovascular disease. But still, compared to an individual who has no diabetes and no cardiovascular disease, if you take an individual of 60 years old, it means 6 years of lives years lost. So we need to do our best as clinicians to prevent this. And how can we do this? First of all, through multifactorial interventions. Yes, glycemic control is important, but all the others are as important. Lifestyle advice, for instance, stop smoking, have a healthy way of eating. Blood pressure control, for instance, include ACE inhibitors or ARBs. Lipid control, have a statin on board if you have an individual with type 2 diabetes, and then also platelet inhibition when you are in secondary prevention. All of these very important. But of course, now we have agents that not only control blood sugar, but they have an effect beyond A1C on protection of organs, the heart, and the kidney. Here I show you an overview for the two classes of agents who have this effect beyond A1C, namely in blue, the SGLT2 inhibitors. I show you three of the big cardiovascular outcome trials, and in yellow, the GLP-1 receptor agonist. Again, I selected a few of the trials. And if you look at the effects given in the darker colors, you see the effect on 3-point MACE. But especially for the SGLT2 inhibitors, you see quite a dramatic effect on the hospitalization for heart failure risk. So let's have a closer look at the effects of these agents. Now, it's not only heart disease that is important in individuals with type 2 diabetes, but also kidney disease. And here an overview of how we're doing in recent years, in the last 30 years. You see that for acute myocardial infarction and stroke, the typically atherosclerotic events, we are doing not a bad job. Indeed, we are seeing improvements. But if you look at end-stage renal disease here in brown, you see that not a lot of movement is there. And indeed, if you look at NHANES, for instance, the big American epidemiological study, you see that individuals with the medium renal failure, stage 3A, having an eGFR between 45 and 60 milliliters per minute, you see that there's even an increase in recent years in the prevalence of chronic kidney disease. Now, let's dive into the SGLT2 inhibitors and their effect on the heart, as promised, and their effect on the kidney. Here, the not only the three first studies, but also the Vertis CV study with the ertugliflozin all together. As you can see, we have now data of more than 30,000 individuals treated with an SGLT2 inhibitor or placebo. Individuals with or secondary prevention or high risk of a cardiovascular disease. Also, if you look at the history of heart failure, this is quite different in the different studies. And also the prevalence of an impaired renal function, so having an EGFR below 60, so 3A or less in chronic kidney disease, you see also there the prevalence is very different. But despite these differences between the trials, if you look at the overall effect, especially the effect on hospitalization for heart failure, you see a clear class effect with decreases of 30% or more in the risk for hospitalization for heart failure. The differences are mainly linked, for instance, in the DECLARE study with the lower prevalence of individuals in secondary prevention. Remember, 60% in DECLARE were in primary prevention. Cardiovascular mortality is a bit more heterogeneous, with there only the EMPA-REG study with empagliflozin showing a 38% reduction in cardiovascular mortality. Three-point MACE, there it is, CANVAS and EMPA-REG that show the effect, and not Vertis and DECLARE. Looking at chronic kidney disease. Here, I didn't take the secondary endpoints of the studies, but the recalculation done by David Cherney, trying to homogenize the endpoints in all of these studies to comparable endpoints, namely those including a sustained reduction in EGFR, needing dialysis or transplantation, or death from renal causes, so excluding macroalbuminuria. And if you take these comparable endpoint definitions, then you see quite an impressive protection of the kidney between 40 and 45%. So quite an impressive protection of the kidney. Now, I want to bring you two more newer studies here, a study where they included not only individuals with type 2 diabetes, but also 33% of individuals without type 2 diabetes, the majority being on their way to type 2 diabetes, but still interesting, they didn't have a hyperglycemia. And here they all had chronic kidney disease, an EGFR between 25 and 75 mils per minute, and or a urinary albumin creatinine ratio between 200 and 5000 milligram per gram creatinine. And that was the DAPA-CKD study. So a study where dapagliflozin as an SGLT2 inhibitor was administered compared to placebo in these individuals. And here you see the very impressive effects on the primary composite outcome, being a sustained more than 50% reduction in EGFR, needing dialysis or transplantation, renal mortality or cardiovascular mortality. You see a 39% risk reduction in those treated with dapagliflozin, 10 milligrams versus placebo. As most of you will know, this study was even ended early by the Data Safety Monitoring Board because they thought it was unethical to go on with a study comparing placebo to such an effective treatment with a highly statistically significant value already after a couple of years. And so this is really now the proof that these SGLT2 inhibitors protect the kidney beyond their effect on hemoglobin A1c, as it also works in individuals without type 2 diabetes. Here, going back again to the observation on hospitalization for heart failure combined with cardiovascular mortality, a 29% risk reduction, again, highly statistically significant. Look at the curves. Already from initiation of therapy, you see the curves going apart, quite a dramatic effect. And important, remember in this population of individuals with an impaired renal function, we have a high mortality. Well, all-cause mortality is decreased by 31%, again, highly statistically significant. Now, why is this? Why is there such a dramatic impact on the kidney? We believe there is a dramatic impact on the kidney, first of all, because of the tubuloglomerular feedback happening with SGLT2 inhibitors. Indeed, when you have an SGLT2 inhibitor on board, you get a blocking of the reabsorption of sodium and glucose in the proximal tubule, meaning that more glucose is coming into the urine, but also more sodium is coming into the filtrate. And that means that more sodium will be passing by the macula densa. And this causes a feedback to the afferent arteriole going to the glomerulus, causing a vasoconstriction. When I say vasoconstriction, some of you may think, ooh la la, I will see what I see with the renin-angiotensin blockers. No, here it is a vasoconstriction of the afferent arteriole, meaning that there is a restoration of the vasodilation happening in individuals with type 2 diabetes normally, when you have less presentation of sodium at this macula densa. So it's like a restoration of the normality happening. Less blood coming to the glomerulus, less filtration, less hyperfiltration in individuals with type 2 diabetes, we believe to be a very important mechanism to protect the kidney. But also, if the proximal tubular cells need to do less labor by absorbing less glucose and less sodium, which is an active process, they will need less oxygen, and so less oxidative stress in the kidney. Also, less activation of the RAS system, less activation of the sympathetic neuronal system, and less inflammation in the kidney. So it's like a perfect good storm happening in the kidney. Also, as I said, there is a general effect of the SGLT2 inhibitors, not only on the kidney directly, there's also less blood pressure, so less pressure on the kidney. And also you get an increase in erythropoietin, so an increase also in your hematocrit, and thus a better oxygenation of your kidney. So clear kidney protection, clear mechanisms why this is happening. But I showed you that there's also this dramatic effect on hospitalization for heart failure in individuals with type 2 diabetes. Well, we have now also evidence in individuals without type 2 diabetes that this protection against hospitalization for heart failure is happening in those without type 2. We have DAPA-HF and we have the EMPEROR studies. DAPA-HF with dapagliflozin, the EMPEROR studies with empagliflozin. First of all, I will show you the data in individuals with reduced ejection fraction. Again, in DAPA-HF, 45% had type 2 diabetes, so the majority didn't have type 2 diabetes. In the EMPEROR reduced study, 50% had type 2 diabetes, and so half didn't have it. In these studies, there was allowed people with an EGFR above 30 in DAPA, above 20 in the EMPEROR studies. They needed an elevated NT-proBNP, and in the DAPA-HF, they needed reduced ejection fraction, and also in the EMPEROR reduced study, they needed a reduced ejection fraction. Now, looking at the effect of the SGLT2 inhibitors in individuals with a reduced ejection fraction, you see both in the EMPEROR reduced and in the DAPA-HF studies an effect on all-cause mortality and cardiovascular death, but it was only in DAPA-HF where this was statistically significant. Looking at the first hospitalization for heart failure or cardiovascular death, or the first hospitalization for heart failure only, they're both of these studies in people with reduced ejection fraction and heart failure, there is this quite dramatic effect, 25 to 30% reduction of hospitalization for heart failure. Now, new is indeed individuals with a preserved ejection fraction happening, the Emperor Preserve just published, where you also have a reduction by empagliflozin for hospitalization for heart failure or cardiovascular mortality by 21%. Again, look at the curves. Very early on, you see this happening. But when you look at the different components of this primary endpoint, you see that everything is driven by hospitalization for heart failure in these people with preserved ejection fraction. Again, empagliflozin missed the cardiovascular death endpoint. Now, what is the mechanism of the protection of the heart failure? Again, it seems like it's a perfect beneficial storm happening. Indeed, a reduction in pre and afterload of the heart happening. You know that there is this small increase in ketones in individuals taking an SGLT2 inhibitor. And so we believe this to be a better fuel for the ischemic heart. Also, the direct effect of SGLT2 inhibitor on the sodium proton exchanger in the heart, extracting sodium from the heart, and also arguments to say there's less inflammation and less fibrosis. And of course, the systemic effect on blood pressure, the better hematocrit, etc., will all give a better oxygenation of the ischemic heart. So again, it's a multifactorial thing protecting the heart. I will end, however, with the bad news. That is that our clinical use of these agents is not well enough. Indeed, here's some data very recent of the year 2021 on clinical use of SGLT2 inhibitors in the US, almost 1 million individuals. All people with type 2 diabetes receiving an SGLT2 inhibitor in 2019, so when many of these studies were already published, only 12% of individuals receive an SGLT2 inhibitor. And if we look at the people with reduced ejection fraction, you see that it's not even 10% of these individuals receiving an SGLT2 inhibitor. Same numbers for those with chronic kidney disease. So we have a lot of work to do. So these are my overall conclusions. Type 2 diabetes is a complex disease with a high cardiovascular risk. We have beta cell failure, that is the reason for the progression of the disease. And we have these big trials that have pushed the GLP-1 receptor agonist and the SGLT2 inhibitors to the forefront in the therapy of people living with type 2 diabetes. Today, I discuss the SGLT2 inhibitors. Our guidelines agree worldwide on the prominent place for GLP-1 receptor agonist and the SGLT2 inhibitors in the algorithm for people with type 2 diabetes, especially those with ASCVD or a high risk of ASCVD, and those suffering for heart failure and CKD. They're mainly the SGLT2 inhibitors. But what we need is an aggressive implementation of these guidelines into our clinical practice. Some of us like to do debates on the differences between all of our guidelines, but we agree that we should just implement these agents, not look at the differences, but look at the commonalities. And I will end with one publicity slide inviting you all to EASD. I know that we just had this EASD, but I hope you will go and look at the online versions and also go to our e-learning pages, esd-elearning.org, where you can register for free and have access to a myriad of modules and courses and debates on everything that is important to treat your patients with type 2 diabetes. So thank you for attending this course.